Hello everyone, welcome back to Labor Standards and Social Legislation. So for this video, we will discuss about recruitment and placement of workers. Pre-employment. So this is the first stage now of the employment process, the pre-employment. So part of the pre-employment is the recruitment and placement of workers. So let's have the statement of objectives. It is the policy of the state to promote and maintain a state of full employment through improved manpower training, allocation, and utilization. To protect every citizen desiring to work locally or overseas by securing for him the best possible terms and conditions of employment. To facilitate a free choice of available employment by persons seeking work in conformity with the national interest. To facilitate and regulate the movement of workers in conformity with the national interest. To regulate the employment of aliens, including the establishment of a registration and or work permit system. So we will discuss later about aliens. To strengthen the network of public employment offices and rationalize the participation of private sector in the recruitment and placement of workers locally and overseas to serve national development objectives. To ensure careful selection of Filipino workers for overseas employment in order to protect the good name of the Philippines abroad. So basically, itong statement of objectives, ito yung goal ng government in crafting the social legislations such as the labor code. So for pre-employment, ito yung objectives ng state. From A to G. So general provisions. So these are the terms or the words or legal words that we are going to use throughout our top our discussion here in pre-employment. So let's start with workers. This means any member of the labor force, whether employed or unemployed. So the definition suggests that a worker may be employed or unemployed. So, hindi ibig sabihin na wala kang work, hindi ka part ng labor force. Part ka pa rin ng labor force, but you are under the category of unemployed worker. For as long as pwede ka na, available ka na mag-work, like you are 18 years old already, then you can be a member of the labor force and therefore, ang tawag sa'yo, worker. Recruitment and placement. Refers to any act of canvassing, enlisting, contracting, transporting, utilizing, hiring, or procuring workers, and includes referrals, contract services, promising or advertising for employment, locally or abroad, whether for profit or not, provided that any person or entity which in any manner offers or promises for a free employment to two or more persons shall be deemed engaged in recruitment and placement. So basically, itong definition na ito, naka-enumerate dito kung ano yung mga acts na nagko-constitute as recruitment and placement. So nakalagay dito sa definition, kahit na nag-canvas ka pa lang ng mga prospective employees, nahanap ka pa lang ng mga magiging employees mo, that is considered already as recruitment and placement. Kahit hindi mo pa siya na-hire. Or kahit na nag-enlist ka lang no ng mga prospective employees or by mere referrals, hindi talaga ako yung mag-hire, nag-refer ka lang, then you are already engaged in recruitment and placement of workers. And here, take note also that if a person promises another a free employment, there is a correction in the definition. That's supposed to be fee employment, no? May bayad, no? Hindi free, hindi libre. To two or more persons, there is a presumption that you are engaged in recruitment and placement. Kahit nag-promise ka lang or nag-offer ka lang sa kanya ng employment, basta yung promise or offer na yan may bayad. So you are deemed to have been engaged in recruitment and placement. Then we also have this term, private employment agency. So ano itong private employment agency? This means any person or entity engaged in the recruitment and placement of workers for a fee, which is charged directly or indirectly from the workers or employers or both. So, sa totoo lang, ang government lang talagang may power, no, to hire, ay to conduct recruitment and placement of workers. Ang government lang talaga. Kasi sabi ng Section 16 of the Labor Code, no person or entity other than the public employment offices shall engage in the recruitment and placement of workers. That is the general rule. Pero, as an exception to the rule, the government or this law, the Labor Code, allows the private sector to participate in the recruitment and placement of workers locally or overseas. Okay? Para ma-regulate nila itong mga private employment agency, kailangan before sila mag-engage as such, kumuha muna sila ng license from the Department of Labor. Kaya meron tayong definition ng license dito, no, sa ating general provisions. It means a document issued by the Department of Labor authorizing a person or entity to operate a private employment agency. We also have private recruitment entity. Means any person or association engaged in the recruitment and placement of workers locally or abroad or overseas without charging directly or indirectly any fee from the workers or employers. So ang kaibahan nila ng private employment agency, meron siyang fee. While yung private recruitment entity, wala siyang fee, no? Walang direct or indirect fee. But here, in private recruitment entity, kung license yung sa private employment agency, dito naman sa recruitment entity, authority, yung document na ini-issue ng Department of Labor authorizing a person or association to engage in recruitment and placement activities as a private recruitment entity. So take note of the differences between a private employment agency and a private recruitment entity. So next term is seaman. So sino ba yung mga seaman? It means any person employed in a vessel engaged in maritime navigation. So alam niyo naman kung ano yung seaman, di ba? Then overseas employment means employment of a worker outside the Philippines. So kaya ang tawag natin sa mga workers natin na nagtatrabaho abroad is overseas Filipino workers. Kasi ang tawag sa employment nila doon sa abroad is overseas employment. Immigrant means any person, worker or otherwise who immigrates to a foreign country by virtue of an immigrant visa or resident permit or its equivalent in the country of destination. So ang kailangan natandaan dito sa immigrant or migrant is that kapag nag-transfer ka na ng residence mo from the Philippines to the foreign country through an immigrant visa, resident permit or its equivalent. So ang tawag sa'yo, immigrant or immigrant. Now let's discuss now the regulations of recruitment and placement. Diba sabi natin, generally, ang government employment offices lang ang may power or authority na mag-engage in the recruitment and placement of workers. Pero, alam naman natin na limited yung resources ng government, kinakailangan nila ng participation from the private sector. Kaya, nagbibigay sila ngayon ng license and authority para makabuo ng either private employment agency or private recruitment agency. Now, ano ba yung mga requirements? So, sino-sino ba yung makaka or eligible for applying for license or authority? So, ito. So, who can participate in the recruitment and placement of workers locally or overseas? So, ito na yung mga qualifications natin. Number one is that only Filipino citizens. Sorry, hindi dapat only yan. Filipino citizen, no? Pwede siyang mag-apply, no, as for private employment agency, no? Or pwedeng corporations, partnership at any and or any entities for as long as at it is owned and controlled by Filipinos at least 75%, no? Owned and controlled by Filipinos. Meaning to say, kung ang capitalization niyan is 1 million, dapat 750,000 pesos of that belongs or owned and controlled by Filipinos. So pwedeng yung 25% ng 1 million belongs to a foreigner. Pwede lang yun siya. Kasi yung sabi ng batas, at least 75% owned. So kapag nag-fall yan below 75%, hindi ka pwedeng mag-participate in the recruitment and placement of workers. So isa yan sa mga basic requirements. So for local employment, so we have private employment agency. Meron din namang private recruitment agency, no, for or entity for local employment. So what are the requirements for the issuance of a license? Ang minimum net worth dapat ng, kapag Filipino citizen lang, single proprietor, at least yung net worth niya is 1 million. Pero kung partnership and corporations yan, dapat yung minimum paid up capital, dapat 1 million. And dapat hindi siya disqualified by law or other government rules or regulations to engage in the business of recruitment and placement of workers for local employment. So ano yun, di ba sabi natin dapat hindi siya disqualified by law. So ano pala yung mga grounds for disqualification? Yung i-disqualify ka na hindi ka pwedeng mag-engage in recruitment and placement. Number one is kapag na-convict ka ng illegal recruitment. Siyempre, di ba? Obvious naman yung reason. Trafficking in person, anti-child labor violation or crimes involving moral turpitude. Like, you were convicted of falsification of documents or estafa. So these are examples of crimes involving moral turpitude. Second is those against whom probable cause or prima facie finding of guilt for illegal recruitment or other related cases exist, particularly to owners or directors or agencies who have committed illegal recruitment or other related cases. Ayan, kahit na hindi ka na-convict, meron lang prima facie finding of probable cause, no, or guilt for illegal recruitment, probability lang, so pwede ka nang ma-disqualify. Those whose licenses have been previously revoked or canceled by the DOLE, like you were previously issued with license and then na-violate mo yung terms ng license mo, kaya na-revoke siya before, tapos ngayon nag-apply ka na naman, so you can no longer apply. For cooperatives, so hindi sila pwedeng mag-apply as recruitment and placement agency. Whether they are registered or not, no, under the Cooperative Act of the Philippines. Law enforcers and any official employee of the Department of Labor and Employment. So the reason is conflict of interest kasi sila naman yung nagre-regulate ng recruitment and placement. Kaya obviously, hindi pwedeng sila rin ang gagawa ng recruitment and placement entities or agency as the case may be. Then, sole proprietors of duly licensed agencies are prohibited from securing another license to engage. Okay, kapag meron ka ng license to engage in recruitment and placement, so huwag ka nang magkuha ng another license kasi bawal yun siya. Sole proprietor, ayan, wrong spelling yung proprietor natin, partnership or corporation license to engage in recruitment and placement for local employment are prohibited from engaging in job contracting or subcontracting activities. Okay? So bawal pala yun, no? Now, what about transferability of license or authority? Pwede ba yun? So under the rules, generally, bawal. Okay? Kapag na-issue yung license sa'yo, bawal mo yan i-transfer sa kahit na kanino. Or bawal ka mag-transfer ng office mo. Dapat yung place of business mo or place of the agency should be the place of agency written in the license or authority. So bawal ka magpalipat-lipat ng area. Exception, any transfer of business address, appointment or designation of any agent or representative including the establishment of additional offices anywhere shall be subject to the prior approval of the Department of Labor and Employment. So, sabi natin kanina, bawal yan na mag-transfer ka ng business address, pero kapag nakakuha ka ng approval, then walang problema. Prohibited practices. So, ito yung mga bawal, no, na mga practices. At kapag nag-violate ka nito, you will be liable for illegal recruitment. So ano ito? To charge or accept directly or indirectly any amount greater than that specified in the schedule of allowable fees. So kasi yung Department of Labor and Employment, meron silang allowable fees, parang taripa. So kapag nag-charge yung private employment agency ng amount greater than that, then isa yun sa mga prohibited practices. So hindi pwede. To furnish or publish any false notice or information or document in relation to recruitment or employment. So, nag-announce ka or nag-publish ka na merong employment dito sa Qatar, example, or sa Canada, pero hindi naman totoo. So, kapag nalaman nila yan, so you can be liable for illegal recruitment. To give any false notice, testimony, information, or document, or commit any act or misrepresentation for the purpose of securing a license or authority. Ito, para makakuha ka ng license or authority, nagsinungaling ka sa mga information tungkol sa iyo. Sinabi mo na isa kang Filipino citizen pero hindi naman pala. So that is a misrepresentation, no, for the purpose of securing a license or authority. To induce or attempt to induce a worker already employed to quit his employment in order to offer him another, unless a transfer is designed to liberate the worker from oppressive terms and conditions of employment. So, ibig sabihin lang nito, kunyari yung employee is nagtrabaho na siya sa Qatar. Ngayon, ini-induce mo siya, sinabihan mo siya na i-quit mo yung job mo dyan sa Qatar kasi meron akong offer sa'yo sa Canada o yung mga ganyan. So, kapag pinilit mo yan siya or in-induce mo yan siya at naniwala naman siya, so you can be liable for legal recruitment, no, for committing this prohibited practice. Unless na lang, tinutulungan mo siya na makawala sa isang oppressive na employment. Kaya, like, merong violence na doon, no, sa employer. Nagkukumit na ng physical violence yung employer para matulungan mo yung worker. So, hindi ka magiging liable, no, kapag i-liberate mo lang siya. No, i-free mo siya from the oppressive terms and conditions of employment. To influence or attempt to influence any person or entity not to employ any worker who has not applied for employment through his agency. Like, kunyari ako, meron ako agency, tapos ikaw, gusto mo mag-apply ngayon, hindi ka sa akin lumapit, no? Hindi ka nagpatulong sa akin. So, sa ibang agency ka lumapit. Tapos, sinabihan ko nga, nalaman ko ngayon na nag-apply ka pala sa ABC Corporation. So, puntahan ko ngayon si ABC Corporation, sabihan ko, wag mo i-employ ito si ano, ha? Kasi hindi siya sa akin hindi siya sa akin pumunta. Sa ibang agency siya pumunta. So, that is a prohibited practice. So, maging ano lang tayo, maging good sport lang, no? Kasi kung meron namang mga iba, hindi natin pwedeng pilitin yung tao na sa atin pumunta. So, kaya kasali siya sa prohibited practice. To engage in the recruitment or placement of workers in jobs harmful to public health or morality or to the dignity of the Republic of the Philippines. So, nag-offer ka sa kanya ng job. Yung job niya is maging prostitute. So, that is harmful or to public to morality, di ba? Or to the dignity of the Republic of the Philippines. Yung mga Pinoy, dinadala lang pala sa ibang bansa or sa itong lugar na ito just for prostitution. So, that is a prohibited practice. To obstruct or attempt to obstruct inspection by the Secretary of Labor, ayan. So, kapag nag-inspect si Secretary of Labor, bawal mong i-obstruct or bawal mong tigilan, i-prevent sila. Kasi meron siyang power of inspection. To fail to file reports on the status of employment, placement vacancies, remittance of foreign exchange earnings, separation from jobs, departures, and such other matters or information as may be required by the Secretary of Labor and Employment. Kasi yung Secretary of Labor, meron din siyang powers, no? Pwede niyang i-require yung agency na magbigay ng mga reports. Kasi di ba, isa sa mga statement of objectives na nabasa natin kanina is to facilitate and regulate the movement of workers, no, movement meaning hiring, promotion, transfer, etc., no, yung status ng employment niya. So meron talagang power yung Secretary of Labor. Kapag hindi ka nakapag-file ng report, then that is a prohibited practice and therefore you can be liable for illegal recruitment. To substitute or alter employment contracts. Ayan, pag-usapan na ninyo na 500 pesos yung monthly salary niya. ay sorry, yung daily salary. Pero yun ang nakalagay sa contract, pero yung totoo, 300 pesos lang yung binibigay mo sa kanya. So that is substitution or alteration of employment contracts. To become officer or member of the board of any corporation engaged in travel agency, or to be engaged directly or indirectly in the management of a travel agency. Kasi bawal kasi na yung mga board ng travel agency, sila din yung board ng private employment agency or private recruitment agency. Kasi di ba, hindi ka pwedeng lumabas ng bansa, kunyari abroad to, hindi ka pwedeng lumabas ng bansa kapag hindi ka dumadaan sa POEA, yung Philippine Overseas Employment Administration or Authority. So, kailangan mong dumaan doon. So, kung may-ari ka ng travel agency or meron kang aeroplano, so you can just, pwede mo lang silang i-travel, no, from the Philippines abroad, no, without going through the process, to through the government offices, no? So, magkakaroon ng conflict ngayon. Kasi conflict of interest, no? Kasi you are an owner of a travel agency and at the same time an owner of an employment agency or recruitment agency. Okay? Then to withhold or deny documents from applicant workers before departure. Yung kunyari, wala siyang kakayahan pa na magbayad ng fee for the recruitment, no, or the employment. Tapos ngayon, ayaw mo siyang paliparin. So, nag-withhold ka, dininay mo yung travel documents niya, so hindi siya makapunta ng ibang bansa. So, that is a prohibited practice. Kasi, bakit prohibited yan? Kasi, nasa batas kasi na hindi ka pwedeng maningil ng fee until na hindi siya makapagtrabaho. So, kailangan secure mo na siya ng employment at makasweldo mo na siya bago ka maningil ng fee. Meron yan sa Labor Code of the Philippines. So kung mag-withhold ka, hindi mo siya paliparin. So, paano kanya mababayaran ngayon? So, that is a prohibited practice. So, what are the powers of the Secretary of Labor? Ayan, enumerate na natin, no? Ito yung mga nakalagay sa Labor Code. Actually, hindi ito sa isang section lang, no? Pero inisa na lang natin. So, the Secretary of Labor and Employment shall have the power, number one, to suspend or cancel any license or authority to recruit employees for overseas employment for violation of rules and regulations. So, pwede silang mag-suspend or mag-cancel ng license or authority. Second, to restrict and regulate the recruitment and placement activities of all agencies within the coverage of the law. Ayan, meron talaga silang power na i-regulate yung mga private recruitment entities or agencies, as the case may be. To issue orders and promulgate rules or regulations to carry out the objectives and implement the provisions of the Labor Code. May at any time inspect the premises, books of accounts, and records of any person or entity. So ito yung kapag pinagbawalan mo silang mag-inspect, then magiging liable ka. To require to submit reports regularly on prescribed forms and act on any violations. Ayan yung mga powers ng Secretary of Labor. Now, let's talk about overseas recruitment. Okay, we have this Overseas Employment Development Board. So, this is created to undertake in cooperation with relevant entities and agencies a systematic program for overseas employment of Filipino workers in excess of domestic needs and to protect their rights to fair and equitable employment practices. So, it shall have the power and duty to promote and overseas employment of Filipino workers through a comprehensive market promotion and development. Da dapat yan, to promote the overseas employment. To secure the best possible terms and conditions of employment of Filipino contract workers on a government-to-government basis and to ensure compliance therewith. To recruit and place workers for overseas employment on a government arrangement and in such other sectors as policy may dictate, and to act as secretariat for the Board of Trustees of the Welfare and Training Fund for Overseas Workers. So, let's talk about direct hiring. So, generally, bawal mag-direct hire. Ito yung nag-apply ka lang online, then lumipad ka, pagpunta ka ng abroad as a tourist. Pero, ang totoo pala, magtatrabaho ka abroad. That is direct hiring. So, sabi ng labor code, no employer may hire a Filipino worker for overseas employment except through the boards and entities authorized by the Department of Labor and Employment. So, bawal ka dumiretso doon sa employer mo abroad without going through the Overseas Employment Development Board and such other entities as may be authorized by the Department of Labor and Employment. Gaya ng kapag seaman ka, kailangan kang dumaan sa National Seaman Board. Okay? But an exception to the rule is hiring of members of the diplomatic service, officials and employees of international organizations and such other employers as may be allowed by the Department of Labor and Employment, exempt sila sa provision on direct hiring. So kung ikaw ay consul or employee ka ng ano international organization, so hindi na kailangan dumaan pa sa board, no? Sa Overseas Employment Board or sa National Seaman Board. Mandatory remittance of foreign exchange earnings. So, ito yung ano, yung mga overseas Filipino workers. Kapag meron silang income abroad, merong mandatory remittance. Anong ibig sabihin nito na kailangan yung kita mo abroad, dapat may share yung families mo dito sa Philippines. So, merong percentage yan. Na, let's say for example, 70% of your earnings abroad will go to your families, dependents, and or beneficiaries in the country. No? Here in the Philippines. So, a portion of your earnings. Kaya kailangan na dumaan talaga sa Overseas Employment Development Board para ma-regulate ito. Kasi may pipirmahan dito yung overseas Filipino worker. Kung magkano yung iiwan niya sa kanyang families. Under the the law, kapag seaman or mariner, 80% ng iyong foreign exchange earnings mapupunta sa families and dependents and or beneficiaries. Kapag ikaw ay worker of Filipino contractors and construction company, 70% lang, basta construction. Pag ikaw naman ay doctor sa ibang bansa, engineer, teacher, nurse, or other professional worker whose contract provide for free board and lodging, then 70%. All other workers, kung hindi ka seaman, hindi ka employed sa construction companies, hindi ka professional sa ibang bansa, 50% yung mandatory remittance. Pero may mga exceptions to the mandatory remittance, ha? So hindi lahat, no? What if, for example, lahat ng family mo nandun na kasama mo sa ibang bansa? So, hindi na kailangan na mag-deduct ng remittance kasi sino naman ang pagbibigyan mo sa Pilipinas kung nandun na sa ibang bansa lahat kasama mo? Or if yung Filipino is nag-work sa US military installations, so hindi siya required na magbigay ng mandatory remittance. Filipino servicemen. Immigrants and Filipino professionals and employees working with United Nations agencies or specialized bodies. So, exempted sila from the mandatory remittance. Kapag na-fail ka na mag-remit nito, for workers, magkakaroon ng penalty of suspension or exclusion from the list of eligible workers for overseas employment or you can be repatriated, no? Pwede kang ibalik sa Pilipinas. Kapag ang employer naman yung nag-violate nito, exclusion from the overseas employment program. So hindi ka na masasali doon sa mga employer sa listahan ng government. Now, let's talk about illegal recruitment. So what is illegal recruitment? Any act of canvassing, enlisting, contracting, transporting, utilizing, hiring, or procuring workers and includes referring, contract services, promising, or advertising for employment abroad, whether for profit or not, when undertaken by a non-licensee or non-holder of authority or even a licensee or holder of authority for as long as nag-violate siya or nag-commit siya ng any act, any prohibited act, no? So, kailan ba nakukommit yung illegal recruitment? Number one is, kapag ikaw ay non-licensee or non-holder of authority, wala kang license, wala kang authority, tapos nag-hire ka ng mga persons, nag-o-offer ka ng employment. So, that is illegal recruitment. Kasi nga sabi natin, di ba, yung government lang talaga ang may authority na mag-engage in recruitment and placement. Pero para ma-lessen yung burden ng government, binigyan nila ng license or authority yung mga nasa private sector. Pero hindi ka pwedeng mag-conduct ng recruitment and placement kung wala kang license at or authority, di ba? Pero hindi lahat ng ng licensee or holder of authority exempted na from illegal recruitment. Di ba? I-recall natin yung mga prohibited practices. Kapag ikaw ay licensee or holder of authority, nag-commit ka ng any act which is prohibited under the labor code, then you can still be liable for illegal recruitment, no? Like for example, yung nag-exact ka ng money, goods, or services in consideration of employment in an amount exceeding, di ba? Yung greater than that specified in the schedule of allowable fees, yung nag-exact ka ng money. Or merong mga false pretense or false documentation, di ba? Remember. Remember nyo lang yung listahan ng prohibited practices. Okay, so economic sabotage. So it's either, this is qualified illegal recruitment. So I haven't finished my slide here, no, this part, but I will discuss to you two kinds of offenses, no, which constitute an economic sabotage. Number one is by a syndicate. Syndicated illegal recruitment or illegal recruitment by a syndicate. And we also have illegal recruitment committed in large scale. So ano ang kaibahan ng syndicated at large scale? Kapag sinabing syndicate, if it is carried out by, come on, so if it is carried out by a group of three or more persons conspiring and or confederating with one another in carrying out any unlawful or illegal transaction, enterprise, or scheme. So, kapag ang offenders ay at least three or more persons, so at least three persons, the illegal recruitment is considered committed by a syndicate. So, three or more persons, yan lang yung tatandaan nyo sa syndicate. Kapag large scale naman, if the illegal recruitment is committed against three or more persons individually or as a group. So ito naman is yung victims, tatlo, at least tatlo na victim. Kahit isa lang yung nag-commit ng crime ng illegal recruitment, kung ang victim niya tatlo, so yung illegal recruitment is committed in large scale. So, ano yung mga penalties for illegal recruitment? So, we have imprisonment, no, of not less than 2 years, nor more than 5 years, or a fine of not less than 10,000 or more than 50,000 or both. Such imprisonment and fine at the discretion of the court. Kapag ikaw ay non-licensee or non-holder of authority, ang penalty mo is 4 years, not less than 4 years, nor more than 8 years. So, mas malaki yung penalty mo kasi wala ka namang license, wala kang authority. Then, for corporation, partnership, association, or entity, yung penalty na inimpose sa mga officer ng corporation, kasi sila naman yung nagpapatakbo ng corporation, partnership, or association. So, yung penalty sa kanila dapat i-impose, hindi sa corporation. And if such officer is an alien, so i-deport siya without further proceedings. Then, in all cases, there would be an automatic revocation of the license or authority and all permits and privileges granted to such person or entity, as well as the forfeiture of the cash and surety bonds in favor of the Overseas Employment Development Board or the National Seymour Board, as the case may be, both of which are authorized to use the same exclusive to promote their objectives. Now, in our last topic, employment of non-resident aliens. So, dito, this speaks of foreigners, ha? Yung mga foreigners na hindi dito nakatira sa Pilipinas. So, before ka mag-employ ng non-resident alien here in the Philippines, dapat meron munang tinatawag nating employment permit, no, for non-resident aliens. So, mag-obtain muna ng employment permit from the Department of Labor and Employment. Pero, second is, hindi ka basta-basta makapag-hire ng non-resident aliens dito sa Pilipinas. Kung meron namang available Filipinos, no, na pwedeng, na competent, able, and willing na mag-employ or mag-work for a particular service in the Philippines. So, hindi pwedeng anytime mag-hire ka ng non-resident alien. Makaka-hire ka lang ng non-resident alien, aside from the employment permit, kung there is a non-availability of person in the Philippines who is competent, able, and willing at the time of application to perform the services for which the alien is desired. Kung wala talagang Pinoy na pwedeng mag-work or pwedeng mag-service ng particular service na yan. So saka pa na you are allowed to employ a non-resident alien. So, ito yung mga prohibition and penal sanctions. After the issuance of employment permit, the alien shall not transfer to another job or change his employer without prior approval of the Secretary of Labor and Employment. So, bawal kang maglipat-lipat ng residence. Kasi, kailangan kang i-monitor ng government. Any non-resident alien who shall take up employment in violation of the provision of this title and its implementing rules or regulations shall be punished in accordance with the provisions of Articles 289 and 290 of the Labor Code. So, kapag nag-violate ka, may non-resident alien na wala siyang employment permit, so magiging liable siya, no? Under 289 and 290. In addition, the alien worker shall be subjected to deportation after service of his sentence. So, ipapauwiin siya sa kanyang country. So that ends my discussion for recruitment and placement of workers. So I hope you learned a lot for this subject. See you next video.